Hey Sushan, what's going on? My last video kind of jacked up there. I noticed OBS is. I'm finding out that OBS is the culprit. It wants to jack up the synchronization with my lips, so I end up with Dubb's disease by the end of the video. That's not good. So I fudged with some settings. I turned off all the filters on the mic that I got suggestions about from YouTubers on how to make my mic sound way better. And it's like, you know what? Let them hear static. There's probably a lot of static. There's going to be a lot of jet noise, car traffic, people screaming outside, drug dealers shooting each other, human traffickers. Anyway, let's escape all that and listen to this.
Warning. We are stepping away from our regularly broadcasted show tonight. There will be descriptions of actions that are not suitable for all. Please be mindful of yourself and those who might be watching with you.
Mindful of yourself?
Disturbing descriptions of gore, violence, as well as depiction.
Inhaling frequencies will not help you tonight.
Oh. What was that? Is he going to describe this body horror without laughing about it? Or is he going to be serious and make this a horror game like it should be?
Right. Welcome to our one shot of Alien, the RPG. I'm joined here with a few of my old friends. Of course, y'all who have tuned in to Clear Skies, y'all know Sam Delev and one.
Two people shaved their heads for this? What's going on here? Is someone supporting someone else's shaved head stuff? Was it? What month was this? What's a good month to shave your head in? Not March. Not is April shave month? What's going on here?
Aki, our legendary Aki. But introducing to you our good friend Alex Ward, who.
He's got the foft hair going on. He's got the Professor DM going on here.
Who had time to pull fangs out of his mouth to come fly with us in deep space. For those of you who may not be familiar with him, I'd like to introduce you to Ed Doty, who
Hello.
Is an old friend of ours, used to be
What the heck? Is this autism or is this the crazy person from Seattle? They don't clap, they wave their hands. Magic fingers?
A co-worker at Geek & Sundry back in the day. If you know the show Vast, it's because Eddie got Vast made. He's an old friend. And
happy hands? What's going on here?
And Eddie, you work for Twitch now, don't you?
I do work for Twitch now.
What do you do for Twitch?
I'm a content strategist, and that is way fancier than it actually is. It sounds fancier than it is. No, I work with like Twitch channels for like media partners. So like media companies that have Twitch channels, that's usually what I work on.
Right on. Yeah. Are they gonna be pissed off if I have you mutated and killed tonight?
That's our Q4 plans. So to mutate and kill me. So we're a little ahead of the game, but not by much.
Okay. Cool. All right. As you all know, Clear Skies usually is in this time slot. We're taking the night off. The crew's on shore leave, except for two who just really like to be punished and asked and decided to sign up and do tonight's game. So some quick heads up for people who are not familiar with the Alien RPG. This is published by Free League Publishing. If you watch my streams, you hear me talk about them incessantly. I am obsessed with Free League Publishing, particularly Forbidden Lands, but they published this baby. This will be my first night running this game. So this is going to be an interesting tech. We are running a scenario that is pre-published called Chariot of the Gods. However,
however,
I'm putting my own spin on it and doing whatever I want with it, because I don't want to tell a story that's predictable, and I kind of want to throw everybody a little bit of a curveball. So it's based on Chariot of the Gods.
Well, that's good.
And before we get started,
that's actually an original idea. Using the adventure as a setting instead of as a story.
I just want to give a big shout out and thanks to Tino Stark, who came up with this great overlay for us, who did a lot of the graphics for us, does great work. Thank you very much, Tino, for all your brilliance. here's how I want to start this game tonight. First of all, I don't want you to tell me about your character. I don't want you to tell the audience
Yay.
Your character. I don't want any details about who you're playing.
Good.
I want you to show us who you're playing.
Oh my God. What? Okay. I subbed to this channel thinking, I'll probably unsub by the end of the video. I might still unsub. Who knows? Maybe they'll get my high hopes up.
Narrative opens. However you choose to do that is totally up to you as the player.
Yay.
Whether it be through attitude or introduction, however you want to do it.
Yay.
But leave this to the fact that you have all been journeying together for some time right now. And I'm going to go ahead without any further ado and just jump right into our narrative. So are you guys ready to get started tonight?
Yeah.
Lots of mute
buttons. Absolutely not. Let's go.
All right. All right.
Is she dressed like Ripley from the third movie, Alien 3? That's one of my favorite movies. Everyone hates that one, though. It's like, really? You like the fourth one better than the third one? Is that what you're telling me?
Let's go ahead and get started. All right, so then I'm going to be reading this excerpt right out of the Chariots of the Gods book.
Good.
You are space truckers on the star freighter USCSS Montero, running the Gauntlet, the trade route between Anchor Point Station and the Frontier. The ship's cargo hold is packed with dozens of tanks of dangerous tritanium gas, or is it tritium gas?
It don't matter.
It is in the process of decaying into an extremely profitable helium-3. Usually, cargo goes through these. Cargo such as this is towed in a massive tanker modules that are transported by much higher concentrations of the gas at a safe distance from a freighter hauler. The Montero isn't rated as a commercial towing vehicle, however, and this small craft, this small run, is a special order from Weyland Yutani corporate account of Sutter's on Sutter's World, a newly established frontier colony. While the trip so far has been fairly routine, the Montero's sensors have developed a glitch before you left Anchor Point, and sporadically being pinged for a contact in the sensor's reflections before you activated the displacement drive and went FTL. Now, you're just awakening from hypersleep, ready to deliver your goods to the colony of Sutter's World. We're going to say you're about 24 hours away from destination, and coming out of hypersleep just as Mother has initiated deceleration. Each of you coming out of the grog of hypersleep, once again, it's a sensation that's quite familiar to you. You all know.
Yeah, let me fix this. Let's see. That one's my camera. Let's put me over here somewhere. Make me tiny. And then this one here. Make it big, man. Make it big. Oh, yeah. That's good enough, right? Oh, it's gonna snap on me. Which way is it gonna snap? We'll have it snap that way. Or I could do this. Ooh. And then I can do this. Ooh. Perfect. Sort of. Oh. Still wants to snap. What's with the snap, man? Does it have to be snapping? Okay, put that there. Ba-da-ba. Put me here. Move me here somewhere. There we go. Just lock me in here. There we go. Good enough.
Know the life. That sort of blurry white blob that you see in your vision, that is the overhead iridescent light shining down through the glass that protects you in your sleep. You can hear the low hum of the module itself activating in the as it slides down a track, opening you up to the atmosphere of the interior part of the cryo bay. Immediately, a wave of nausea rushes over all of you, mixed with a level of exhaustion as your heart rate begins to spike. It is always disorienting, unpleasant, and vomit-inducing. In your own pace, each of you began to pull yourselves up from the med bay, right off of your bed for the first time in months, pushing yourself up off the pad. That wave of dizziness comes over you. Some of you managed to successfully aim for the bucket. Some of you don't even bother. You'll get it later. It needs to come out, and it needs to come out right now. It's a familiar sound that all of you, it's like the crew hello at this point. Every time you all journey on one of these long-range missions, usually one of the first things that you're greeted with is your fellow truckers waking up and hearing the noises of them gagging and throwing up and chuckling and laughing or poking fun at one another. The lights flicker on as the interior of the cabin of the USS Montero begins to flicker on, and you hear overhead Mother's voice just saying,
"It's not the USS, it's the UC, it's the USCSS.
Arriving at destination in 24 hours, cryo sleep discontinued. Good morning." Our captain, taking a good look around, you see the crew pulling themselves up.
All right. Sitrep, how's everyone doing? Davis?
Yeah, Captain, doing fine. Fine. Okay. I don't exactly understand why they tell us we should eat something before we do these, but whatever. Anyways.
It's so that when you wake up, you don't have a sugar attack. Golly.
I guess so. But in any case, I probably should just go make sure that, we're on the right heading. Not that we're ever anything but on the right heading. Jeez. Predictability of these things. So much fun. Anyways, I'll go check the helm. I'll be back if you need me.
Okay.
Your bare feet touch down on that harsh grating that's underneath the bed that you wake up from. And your feet, I mean, having not touched the ground, they're actually kind of tender. And there's this shock of, like, the cold metal on your toes as your feet touch down. It's like those mornings, if you've ever walked on that asphalt that's just made of like pebbles in concrete, and your feet kind of touch down on them, it immediately sends that discomfort of like spikes into your heel. It's the same sensation, even though the ground isn't quite the same. Always takes a little getting used to as the tingling sensations race up your leg for a second. But pushing yourself off the med bay, you manage to make your way over to the door. Slides open. And Davis, you disappear into the hall, headed towards the bridge.
Rye, anyone have eyes on Rye?
Right here. Important information to report, Captain. Cham missed the bucket again.
Fuck you. Cham just looks up from his... Cham just looks up from his medical bed. Some a single drop of vomit coming off the edge of his the beard that he's got, that scraggly looking beard. He just looks up at you with venom in his eyes as he spits that out at you.
All right, that at ease that noise. All right, take 10 minutes. Get situated and everyone get ready. Rye, when you get a chance, just want to check the tritium H3 degradation levels. No rush, but let's get that within 15, yeah?
Yeah. Thanks, Cap.
All right.
You can, by the way, if you choose, to describe your characters to each other so that everyone's got a pretty good idea of what everyone looks like. So if you'd like to give us a visual.
Skip. Are we going with as described in the...
You can go with their pre-made description. Cronus. And underneath that listing pops up that the ship itself has been listed as missing. This is a Wayland SEV M3 Helides class science exploration vessel that's been listed missing for 75 years.
Well, that answers whether or not this was a Wayland vessel.
Holy shit. 75
fucking years?
Cham gets up from his station and walks over to you, Davis, and leans over your shoulder and looks at it and just goes, holy shit, that's... Hey, do we get a bonus? We just found a missing vessel. 75 fucking years. Holy shit.
There's got to be some salvage, right?
Okay, I like how the NPC said he walks over and leans over, looks at the screen. I like that. That's perfect.
Well, I mean, there is probably a reward for bringing a ship like this back in and recovering such a ship.
Well, then it's good that we're helping people out.
Miller's camera.
I feel good about this.
It's pretty standard. There's also some salvageable parts that we can potentially harvest off of it. Well, hold on. We're under the new lease-to-own program for the ship, and according to regulations, anything that is not of use.
Why do they bring this up? They always have to bring up the ship lease, the contracts. Just because it was a thing in a movie doesn't mean it's got to be brought up in everyone's freaking situation in the future.
Potentially can be seized and repurposed. That's part of the turnkey nature of the captain-ship Yutani relationship. So... once we, I doubt anyone's alive, but should we rescue everybody or salvage any cargo, then I'd like, with minimal delay, to assess and harvest any parts that could benefit this ship. I fail to see a problem with that.
Costs a hell of a lot less fuel to move a few parts than to move a whole ship.
Thank you. I'm certain that if you were to bring in the entirety the ship, Yutani Corp would be very interested in having it back and also rewarding you for those efforts.
Yeah, but we're not rigged to tow anything, Wilson.
Okay, so in this game, one of the players is a robot. Is it going to be Wilson? I'm trying to guess, because they don't say who their characters are in this one, so you have to guess by how the characters are acting. Who is going to be the android?
Wilson, I mean...
Hey, shut up. Let me see if I can figure it out, and then we'll say what we're rigged to tow. I'll take a look at it.
Thank you.
We'll see what I can mock up.
We'll do a damage report on it. We'll assess how much expense in terms of fuel and time it's going to take us to harvest while still delivering the packages we have now. We have an unstable fuel that we're transporting. We cannot risk too heavy of a delay of that without potential damage to the existing cargo. So we're going to do some simple calculus here about what is the most cost-effective method forward.
I have an idea. Cham raises his hand.
Go for it, Cham.
Well, we're hauling 200,000 tons of this shit. If we're trying to drag... If our wonder person over here really thinks that they could rig this ship to start towing... then we're going to need the extra fuel. So maybe if this, Cronus has any more fuel on it, we could siphon the fuel off that ship.
Well, one thing at a time. Let's pull up next to it. Let's dock. Let's get aboard. Let's scan. Let's figure out what exactly we're dealing with to begin with. And just so you all know what I look like, mid-30s, darker complected, ambiguous... ethnicity, male presenting, saddlebags under the eyes, very tired, but consistent in purpose and in energy and in delivery.
I thought they were done with the character description stuff. Anyway, so far I like this. I like this this role play.
Does the whole debate club this thing when you point? Just because.
Talks like a politician, gestures like a politician when he's trying to make a point, kind of thing.
Well, back in junior year of college, he learned that this was bad, but this is less offensive for some reason.
Just JFK. Don't do any of this shit, and we should.
JFK did it.
Fair enough.
All right. So
Teddy Roosevelt did it.
Alter course. There is the artificial gravity of the ship does protect you all from the slightly jarring sensation of the deceleration and the alteration of course, but it does, at least you can feel it in the deck plates. You can feel it in the hull of the ship as you guys begin to essentially take a swing, a left turn. Chan makes sure to note the change in ship's log as you all set thruster control and deviate the USCSS Montero. And you start heading in the direction way off the beaten path, way off of charted navigational, the typical routes that take ships from point A to B. You are now venturing into the woods, as it were, and charting in deeper into space. What you notice on the 6-hour journey is that, first of all, there's nothing out here. Where the ship was coming from or going is very difficult to determine. But as you are getting closer, Mother is able to detect that the ship is almost at, the engines have been deactivated, it is adrift. So it's possible that it was on course. 75 years is quite a long time to go floating off into space, however. So it's very difficult to tell where the ship was coming from. Does anybody have anything that they are doing in particular or want to have a scene in the 6 hours you were journeying to
good question. Cronus? This is a good question. Who is this guy running this game? He's doing a great job. He's kind of like a facilitator, but he's also open to roleplay ideas. You know, this is the age-old question in Traveler. You're going to be in Jump for a week. Do you guys want to just fast travel there? Did you want to roleplay some of that 1 week encounter on board the ship? There's not many YouTubers that even go do this. No matter what the game system, there's hardly anyone that does this. I'm shocked. I don't know what to do with myself.
Which, by the way, responding to their hails, you receive dead silence.
Yeah, it's going to take forever to get a message back. Forever. If there's nothing to ping, it's going to take forever.
I think that Davis has probably been hanging out in the cockpit, making course corrections where necessary. And they have like a baseball that they keep in there in the cockpit with them that they like to toss up and down just to like give them some stimuli. Mm-hmm. To, like,
yeah, you're just doing this. Gordon. Just but doing this with
the cockpit. They like.
You have a catcher's mitt, and you're just going
throw it at them. Unless Wilson comes by, and then like they'll actually like fast.
When you throw the baseball up one last time, it stays. It doesn't come back down. It's like, what? Some guy's been playing jokes with the artificial gravity.
Fast pitch that motherfucker and like try and throw him off. Just because.
All right. I'll come in.
All right. So stepping back on the bridge, it's been a few hours. So the bridge itself is expansive with large windows towards the front. And just because I love the aesthetic and we're a little nostalgic here.
Yeah, it's 70s Ron Cobb style architecture in space. Maybe wall-to-wall carpeting, who knows?
The bridge does have the same nostalgia. In fact, it is in fact a very similar, it's just an updated version of the Nostromo. So the bridge actually looks almost exactly the same. You do have that 70s aesthetic of like the computers with the blinking lights all over the place and the thick glass screens displaying these vibrant green and blue colors, digitally displaying exactly where you are in the galaxy at this point. Of course, the vastness of space is displayed every time you look at these readouts and displays. It is a constant reminder to each of you of the taxing nature of the lifestyle you've chosen. You are in the middle of nowhere's nowhere. You are beyond the eye of the void. This is in the middle of nothing. And the only indication that there is anything around you in any direction are the pinpoints of light that are the stars. The computer is the only thing letting you all know that you're still floating somewhere into the universe. And on occasion, you will detect a distant celestial event that probably took place decades prior that is now showing up on readouts. the monotony of space travel cannot be, there's a reason why cryosleep has become incredibly important. It's always mentally challenging to any human being for extended journeys through deep space. And a lot of you are enjoying what essentially is an adrenaline rush of being awake for the first time in months. But all of you, save perhaps Wilson, all of you who are very familiar with this sort of mode of travel, you're all very experienced and aware that this rush wears off and you get what's called the deep space crash, where as soon as that adrenaline wears off and the monotony starts to kick in, as Davis likes to call it, this becomes pretty taxing. So everyone's kind of reserving their energy, cracking jokes, throwing barbs, and doing what they can to stay focused on their work, but enjoying being up and moving around. I would say about 3 hours into this trip, Davis, as you're sitting at the comms, as you're sitting at the controls, you see once again a faint shadow of a sensor blip appear and vanish instantly. So fast, you don't get a triangulation of exactly where it is located in relation to your ship. It literally mother detects what looks like a shadow and it's gone. But this is the third time. So I will give your character this. Davis's instinct is telling them probably not a sensor glitch.
Yeah, three times is a fucking pattern. Miller, you said you were going to come into the cockpit, yeah?
You're muted.
Yes, I
will. Sup, Cap?
Oh, what are we looking at?
I don't know. Something's kind of fishy here.
No. What is fishy? Is it a fish?
I mean, aside from whatever it is they're warming up in the fucking galley, who knows? I keep seeing this weird shadow on our sensors, and I'm not sure what it's about, but this is the third time it's shown up, and there's no way that that's a glitch. I don't even know what it is. Like, it moves too fast and Mother can't get a triangulation on it. It just shows up and then disappears.
Well, we're not due for a sensor maintenance for another 6 weeks, and we were really looking forward to not having to do that for another five.
I don't think this is a glitch, Cap.
So what are we thinking? Are we thinking debris? Are we thinking another ship that pops in and out of subspace? Just looking at what the monitor.
Question for the GM then. Is this shadow something that's showing up on the ship as I scan it, or is this outside of that?
It's distant outside. I would say an estimation is probably somewhere in the vicinity of 75 to 100,000 kilometers away.
Yeah, it's not... It's just something out there. I don't know what it is, but it's about 7,500 kilometers out in that nice inky black we call space.
Is it approaching the Cronus? About where will it be? How big is it? Do we know in relation?
To the Cronus? I guess I could try and figure out if there's been any pattern to like the actual like glitch, like whether or not that shadow seems to be moving on some sort of trajectory parallel to ours or like parallel to the Cronus. I could look into that, but.
She's doing a great job. She's not trying to sound all scientific. She's not asking the GM, does my character know how to use sensor scans? Can my character do a skill check to see what the problem is?
Yeah. The next time it shows up, I'll see if I can figure out about where, and then if I can connect the dots, I will.
All right, Davis.
Yeah?
You can make a roll.
I'd love to.
Sure. In that case, I'm going to have you roll wits and observation.
My wits and observation.
First roll of the game.
First roll of the game.
So my wits are 3 and my observation is 2. So that means I'm rolling
a total of 5 dice, and 6s count as successes.
Oh man, I forgot about this. They're using the stupid die mechanic from the game. Why? Why can't you just play Alien using Mongoose Traveler 2nd Edition? Can't you just... Come on!
Okay.
Don't worry about ones.
Right.
I was getting into this.
Sixes. Two, which means you can stunt.
Yes.
Okay. Yippee.
I've played this game once.
She can stunt. Wonderful. They were role-playing so well, and then the dice rolls started.
All right. So there are some suggestions in the rule books to kinds of stunts that you can do, such as having the time that it takes to do an action, or like if you were in combat, you'd be able to disarm somebody. In this case, playing loose with the narrative, I can say that you actually, I'm going to give you a little bit more information if you like, or if you have a suggestion, that how would you like to stunt this?
Oh, cool, cool, cool. Cool, cool. Let the player describe their success. That's amazing. That's amazing. There was an eclipse today in Texas. Does this have anything to do with the eclipse that happened, the solar eclipse that happened in Texas today?
I think at this point, like, Davis has worked with Miller long enough that they don't really need to, like, pull any fast tricks to impress him. Right. So they're probably not going to do any, like, super fancy scanning work or anything like that. I think they're just going to try and push for as much information as possible.
Okay. Mother starts returning some information on the readouts based on some guesstimations that you're making about where this blip appeared on sensors. And you actually do manage to discover that as you're looking at this, whatever it is about 100,000 kilometers away, and it would appear to be in the same arc of the ship that it was the last two times you detected it, which is the rear arc. It's aft.
So it's following us? Okay. Well, I mean, it's definitely moving on.
Mother does not reply.
Good answer.
Well, I mean, at the very least, we figured out that it's behind us and moving along the same trajectory, possibly, as us. So, I mean, adding one and one.
Yep. All right.
Very way likely too following us, but, like, you know. I can't know that for sure until it shows up again. But for now,
where did these guys learn to role play? I want to know. They just came from nothing, from the void. Who taught them how to role play? This doesn't just happen osmosis-like.
Now that's what I got.
All right. Well, this is way too much excitement for a Tuesday.
I thought it was Monday. God.
Yeah, no, it's the 3 o'clock.
Someone's internet.
You have to
I'll realign them. Sorry about that.
Keep tracking its movement. Where's Wilson right now?
Where's Wilson? Yeah. Wilson, where are you?
I've been just kind of staying out of the way and observing everybody's interactions, as is the reason why I'm here. But
what is he? He's the bureaucrat or something?
About the ship. I'm very interested.
Got it. Okay. So now for an in-character question to Davis, which is, do you know where Wilson's at?
Softy's probably in the galley where he's usually hanging.
Easy.
Did you see what he did there? In-character question. Who does that, I say, in character question? No one. I mean, there's a few people that do that, but no one does that. Compared to the rest of YouTube, no one fucking does that.
Easy. But yes, you're not wrong. Comms have ears.
I mean, this guy is supposed to what? Decide our entire freaking futures or whatever? I don't know.
I don't disagree, but I'd ease that noise. All right? Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right. All right. We'll be back. If you see him, tell me.
This is cool. I have to go eat. I'm starving. But I'll put a link in the description below to this actual play. They actually role played. Even with the crap game mechanic, they actually did it, got it over with, and got right back into character. It was a thing of beauty.